things. So 5 days, 5 topics is what I'm going to cover. This is an attempt for people to learn skills at home, try to ensure that they are learning new stuff being home in the lockdown, and know about the types of cyber crimes, how it is, what are the types. So there are 5 topics which I'm going to cover during the week. Today being the generic cyber crime, tomorrow on banking frauds and payment frauds, digital payment frauds, and so on. So we have a special law in our country called the IT Act, which is Information Technology Act. This act allows to punish people who have done something wrong and who are violating the law, misusing the technology for their own advantage, wrongfully causing some loss. So there are some 50 plus 50 odd types of cyber crime which are covered under the IT Act. Along with IT Act, there is Indian Penal Code IPC, which also is applicable at times for cases depending upon the fraud. To explain you in simple words, suppose you use a credit card or a debit card, and when you use a credit card or debit card and you are trying to do a transaction, somebody gets the details through from unauthorized means. They may either skim the card or they may get your card details get compromised. If they use this card to do some purchase or withdraw money, then this is a offense. Now, whether it is a cyber offense or it is a normal offense, it depends, because if you see the nature of this transaction, what they have done is they have used your card details, which is personal to you. Only you as an authorized user should know about it. Nobody else should know the card details. So they have compromised the details which can identify you as a user. So under the IT Act, there is one section through which this can be registered, and it is known as a cyber fraud. Now, apart from that, you receive an email. Now, in the email, they say that you get a job in company ABC. You have to pay 5,000 rupees to schedule your interview. After you pay the money, your interview will be scheduled, and then the further job proceedings and procedures will be completed. Now, they use this name ABC. Now, merely receiving this email is not an offense. Only when you act upon it, or you try to click on the link and make a payment, and then you find out that this company ABC is a fraud company. The payment what you made was taken by the person, but there was no interview scheduled. Then this, though the medium is online and email is used, this is a cheating fraud, and it is covered under the IPC and not under the cyber crime. Only if the company ABC, the original company whose name is misrepresented or identity is stolen by these fraudsters, they can go and do a cyber complaint about their company name getting misused. So based on the complainant, the offense and the section will vary. Every offense, depending on the complainant, the case will it take its own course. So if the complainant in this case is the person who paid the money for the job, then the offense here is of cheating, because he has been duped by the person in giving a job, but there is no job which is offered to him. But if the company whose name is misused, if they complain, then the same offense becomes a identity theft issue, because the identity of the company is being compromised by somebody to dupe somebody on behalf of them. So it is impersonation, cheating by impersonation or cheating by personation. Knowingly that it is wrong, you make somebody believe that the information is true and the person falls trap to it. So there are various such offenses, right from your advance fee schemes. Now, advance fee schemes, earlier it was only based on the lottery, that you have won so and so lottery. If you want the money, you need to pay a processing fee and so on. But now that has got various other streams. So right from your job to insurance to your offers, your festival offers, tickets, railway tickets and stuff. So there are a lot of people who dupe you by giving you incentivized offerings which are not true to be good. Recently, in fact, just 2 hours back I got a case referred from one of the doctors who is right now based out of Bangalore, but he's stuck in Haridwar, and somebody called him saying that we are from IRCTC, you have a train schedule ticket which is supposed to be you'll be getting a refund in UPI, so you need to share your details and download an application. After downloading the application, you will get your money. And the doctor, without understanding that, he installed the software and the OTPs were shared, and he suffered a loss of 9,000 rupees, 4,000 in one transaction, 5,000 in another transaction. And now today in the lockdown, he's struggling to get an FIR registered. So generally, nobody, no entity calls you for any refund. No bank calls you, no company calls you. Your refund money is all automatically processed. So if you are booking a ticket through net banking, then the net banking which was used to book the ticket will get the money. You don't have to give a separate bank account for receiving a refund. There is no such option already there. Now, because people are not aware, they try to get victimized and they fall prey. So this is just 2 hours back. Day before yesterday, in fact 3 days back, there was one person who got duped by a fake app which says that you will be able to see if any person is having coronavirus nearby you. So you kindly download this software, and once you download the software, that software was not authorized from the genuine sources, and his OTPs were leaked, and he suffered a loss of 1,06,000. There was a FIR registered in the suburbs of Mumbai. So in this time when people are at home and they are not able to go out for work or do their daily earnings, fraudsters also have reached you through virtual medium. They try to ask you things and questions in such a way that people feel victimized. They try to, in fact a lot of times people get victimized because of the pharmacy and wine shop frauds. So what happens is people don't use authorized applications to order food or medicine. They go on Google, they do a search. After doing a search, they get first 10 hits. So clicking on one of the hits, they get a mobile number, they call the person that I want so and so medicines, I want so and so food, or I want so and so wine to be delivered at my place. And the other side person may not be the one who he or she claims to be. There have been cases, n number of cases which are reported where so on Google, anybody can claim any business if it is open. There is no verification mechanism which used to exist a couple of months back. Now they have added one layer of control which allows only the owner of the company to claim the business of that. Otherwise, any search, open search, people used to put their own mobile numbers, or fraudster used to use their mobile number as a call center number and then do a fraud. So in this case is what used to happen is people used to give their own, the fraudster used to give their mobile number as a customer care number for the product which was supposed to be purchased, either the medicine or wine or food. And then the fraudster would get this person who is in need of the product to pay the money online. If the person is not paying online, is not ready to make the payment, then he is asked to share the card details or the OTP details. And once the card details and OTP is given, the actual transaction amount would be around 200-300 rupees, but they would use this transaction for some other services like purchasing a ticket or maybe of a flight or other ticket which could be shared or sold in open market in cash. So that's how they used to do people. Lot of typically in the Mumbai suburb areas and South Bombay, the central Mumbai and western Mumbai, a lot of people used to complain that our phone, people are coming to our shop that we have paid you online but you are not delivering the goods. And when we find out, the payment details does not belong to us, the mobile number does not belong to us, but the company name on the search engine used to display our name. So the fraud does not stop or end. It's all evolving every day. You find new instances. Most of us now have become experts in corona healthcare, because same message at least gets repeated in say 10 to 15 groups and some 5 to 6 independent chats, because people are concerned, people care for you, they try to share all the information which are repetitive in nature. Sometimes important messages are left. So how do you find out whether the person sending message is genuine or not, or how do you
understand whether the communication which is there is correct or not. So there are websites which gives you help fake or not, check the fake content. Apart from that, there are authorized government channels where they have set up their own helpline numbers. There are food applications which are supposed to be having tie up with lot of restaurants, so you can use those platforms which are intermediary, which can take care of any fraudulent or malicious activity. When you get involved in one-to-one kind of a relationship, suppose you get an advertisement in the newspaper that work from home and you just have to invest in say laptop and insurance of it, and by doing so you will get 20,000 per month, 40,000 per month, but for the laptop to reach your home you will have to pay the insurance and the transit. So the moment somebody asks you money, it's a red alert. Never entertain anybody, because there is no free food in the world. Nothing comes free at home. So if you want to work, there are, like, currently everybody, most of them are working from home because of the lockdown. They are not supposed to go out of their house. However, what happens is whenever somebody sends any link, first and foremost you should download one app called WOT, which is known as Web of Trust. I will be messaging on also in the chat of this video. So it's called WOT, which is nothing but Web of Trust. This is a plugin. Once you download this plugin in your browser, any website which is malicious, this green signal becomes red. So that could be one alert that this website is not secure. Be careful before sharing any information on that link. Most of the times you get links on your WhatsApp and other messaging groups like Telegram and stuff, and the curiosity levels are so high in us that we forget to check whether the link is genuine or not, whether the information which is being shared is authentic from the authentic source or not, and we tend to believe on it, we tend to rely on it. So all such links, if you use this plugin WOT, you can put this link in this website and it will give you the reputation that this website has a reputation of say 10, 20, 30, 40%, 70%, 80% and above. And this is by people who are in the security community. They rank this based on their experience of how the website is, how fast it takes to load, whether the data gets compromised, whether the data is secure or not. There are other parameters on this. A small tool which can help you protect a lot of details. This can be downloaded into your Android phones and iOS phones also. There is an app which is available on the Play Store and App Store. You can download this app. So once you download, your browser will become VPN, which is known as virtual private network. So all the links that which you are going to use now will be verified and checked whether this is proper or not. So this could be a simple way of downloading one app which helps you to prevent yourself from being a victim. Please ensure you don't click on every and any link that comes to you on your messenger app, because those links can be malicious. By clicking the link also, the entire phone can be compromised. There are codes in that. There are apps which you download from unauthorized sources which takes a lot of permission. So once you give all these permissions, your mobile phone can be read by them, your SMSs can be read by them, your contact call logs can be read by them. They can send message on your behalf. They can use the photograph which is there in your memory, in your SD card, as well as internal memory. So you should avoid downloading such apps. What if you have already downloaded this app and now you want to check whether they are right or not? So there are apps like app permission, myapppermission.org. You can download this application. Once you download this application in your mobile phone, it will tell you that the app which is installed in your phone accesses so many permissions. So if you think that this app is required and without that you cannot work, then you allow that permission, or you can withdraw the permission, or you can uninstall the app. There are times when a lot of the apps do not get installed without you accepting the permission. So what you should do is you should make your phone in a airplane mode and connect the phone through Wi-Fi, download the app. Once you install the app, then you go to permission, disable the permission, and then you connect to the net. So by doing this, what will happen is your phone will not share information because it is in the airplane mode. The application gets installed and only few permissions which are given can be withdrawn back. So that is what you can do. Apart from that, you need to invest in a software which is antivirus software for your phone. Irrespective of your phone, even if you think you have a 50,000 phone, it is secure, it doesn't mean so. These softwares are very economically feasible, right from 200 rupees to 350, 400 rupees for a year. You get softwares. You download these softwares which will help you to protect your phone. If somebody tries to enter wrong PIN or password to your phone, the screenshot will be captured. You will know the person who tried to enter wrong password in your phone. If the phone by mistake gets misplaced or lost, you can track the phone with this software, even if somebody removes the SIM card or the internet is not there, because without that the phone will not be allowed to be work. So there are antivirus softwares to name. Either you can use Quickhill or you can use Kaspersky. Quickhill is an Indian company based out of Pune. I think 200 rupees odd is the software cost. And Kaspersky is available for some 350 or 400 rupees with GST and tax. So by using these softwares, if you can protect your phone, please do that. There is a service called Jio Security. If you are using Jio phone, it has an inbuilt feature of Jio Security, which has a tie with Norton company. So you can track your phone live where it is right now through the web browser. So the phone can be found out. There is a service by Google, Find My Phone. In Apple, there is a Find My Phone app. In Google, there is a app called Find My Device. You can go to the android.com website and type through your Gmail ID, which is used to log in the Play Store. You can track your phone. But for this, you will have to have the location service enabled. If you disable the location service, then this service may not be fully effective. So you need to do this. Some basic hygiene, because most of the things are now based on the mobile phones and you are going to use phones only for everything. First and foremost, your phone should have a password. It should have a password which should not be easily for others to guess, so that your phone, even if it is lying unattended, nobody can misuse it. I got a case a few years back where one of the phones was not locked with a PIN and a password, and one call was made from that phone, and that was a threatening call made by the person who used that phone, and the person who owned the phone was responsible for it, because the phone belonged to him and he did not take responsibility to secure the phone. So you can be also held liable if there is a misuse through your devices, because law does not differentiate between the right and the wrong. It is how much have you taken care to ensure that there is nothing wrong happening from your end, and after this efforts been taken, if something still happens wrong, then you will be pardoned or excused if the discretion of the judicial mind is there. So always remember that protecting your device is your responsibility. You can't say that I was using this software and because of this software this happened. It doesn't solve any purpose. It is it depends on what kind of applications you are using, what phones. So generally what I do as a best practice, I have two phones. Not everybody can afford one, but generally in one phone I do all my banking operations and my emails, which are secure. It doesn't have any of my social networking applications. And one phone I use, which has all my social networking applications and WhatsApps and stuff. So my main phone is separate. It has only my official email and correspondence related to work. And other phone is my leisure phone, which I use for my other activities online. So that if at all there is something wrong, my main phone, my banking apps which are there, does not get compromised. I always prefer and suggest to do digital banking. Try to use it through your web browsers. That is the most safest one, because you have your computers. Assuming that you use licensed softwares, do not encourage in using pirated software, because even if you use a pirated software and licensed antivirus, it will serve no good. So better you use a licensed software, a licensed OS, and do your basic stuff, net banking online. It is more easy to detect online frauds than the physical fraud. I would suggest you people to also use two-factor authentication, which is a free service inbuilt by most of the service provider. There are people who do not use two-factor service. It's the best thing, and also don't try to download software from other unknown sources which you are not sure. So Play Store right now, if you see, they are giving you Play Protect kind of a symbol before an app is being downloaded. So that means the application is already doing an audit. They are checking whether this app is as per their standards or not, and if they find anything suspicious, they will not allow the app to be hosted. But earlier there are apps which were not being done, security testing was not being done, so those were the issues found out. Most of the times people think cyber crimes are, you know, hackers will hack your stuff. So I will want to clear one myth: your email cannot be compromised by anybody in this world. Only in the three conditions it can be compromised. The first is if your password is easy to guess and there is no two-factor password with that. Second, if the question answer of your email security question answers are easy to answer, then the person can reset it. And the third, if there is a keylogger, that is a software which will capture each and every keystrokes which you type from your phone or from your computer. If there is a keylogger or a malware which is already in your device, then only the password of the email can be compromised by the fraudster. Your emails are very secure. They cannot be compromised in any condition. Nobody in the world can compromise your email except these three conditions. So your password should be very strong, at the same time easy for you to remember. We have seen people keeping passwords like their pet names, your mobile numbers, your date of birth, your anniversary, your wife's name, your kid's name, and that's how the email gets compromised. Also, you should not be using your personal email account which you use for social networking with the bank for receiving bank statements, because most of the apps today, when you go online, they say either you log in from using Google or log in using Facebook. If you link your Google account and the same account is for your Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, bank account, then all the details which are there in your email can be read. Because if I doubt whether you read it, when they ask you for permission, they say that we will be able to read the emails from your inbox. So always have two email IDs, one official for your banking and other work, and one which would be used for your social networking sites. So there's one question: which app did you say for Android phone? So there are two apps you need to download. One is Web of Trust, that is to ensure the links are not malicious, and second is My Permissions. So when you download this My Permission, this app will tell you how many apps that are already installed in your phone, what permissions they have already taken. One more app that you need to download is called YOURHOUR, Your Hour. So what does this software do? It tells you that how much time you spend on a day in a phone in a particular app. So you can control your addiction of phone with the help of this software, which will ensure you that you do not waste more time unproductively on the phone, but you use some good sites and good applications that will help you for your productivity rather than wasting time. So My Permissions is also one more application which you need to download. I'll be sharing the links of these apps for Android as well as iPhone on the video chat once the video gets over. I have 5 more minutes before I conclude. So those who are online, if you have any questions, you can chat right away. Mention here, I will answer those. Or in the next 5 minutes, I'm going to go to Twitter to answer questions from people. If you have any questions, any on cyber, or if you want to know about a particular fraud in terms of whether this classifies as a cyber crime or not. If yes, because I have tomorrow, I'm going to purely talk about banking frauds, then I'm going to talk about the law, then I'm going to talk about evidence. What is important evidence? If suppose there is a case where you are victimized, and then what is forensic analysis and how do you retrieve data so that you get the gist of this domain. This is all I'm just trying to give you my 14 years plus experience, so that people get more sensitized about the softwares they use, more responsibly they use the technology, and we also ensure that we follow hygiene to not fall prey. There is also one app which you can download on Android, which is called Cybercrime Clinic. It gives you most of the details about various types of cybercrime, preventive tips, what to do in case of you are victimized, contact details of police stations nearby, how to report crime, what should be the complaint content. So this is currently only available for Google Play Store and not for other iPhone, because the iPhone says that it should be a book and not an app, so it needs to be converted into an iBook for iPhone users. But currently this is available on Android phone. You can download Cybercrime Clinic app. It gives you, it's a FAQ app which gives you simple examples, simple provisions of the law under which it is punishable and stuff. Apart from that, what you need to take care is today, because if you're using phone and if you can afford a good phone, I would say, I'm not marketing here, but I found Oppo Color OS features much more secure compared to Samsung and other phones, which I've tried, even iPhone for that matter. The screen recording, screen logging, the screen security is there. Paytm fraud, there's a question that tells something about Paytm fraud. Now Paytm fraud, you'll have to wait for tomorrow 5 p.m. because tomorrow entire session is on digital payment fraud, about wallet fraud, banking fraud, UPI fraud. So I'm going to cover that tomorrow. So today I'm not going to answer this, but you'll have to wait for tomorrow 5 p.m. Apart from this, so last 2-3 minutes before I conclude, or 4 minutes, you need to download My Permission app. You need to download WAT Web of Trust app at least. You need to download a paid antivirus, either Quickheal or Kaspersky. I have tried and tested both the apps. So whichever you are comfortable, I think one is for 200 rupees, one is for 450, 400 rupees odd amount. But either of the software is good. You can try both. If you are using Windows computer system, I would strongly suggest you to download and use paid version of Quickheal along with ransomware support. So that will ensure your computers are safe and they avoid ransomware. And if at all, if there is something which of that sort, which is likely to be faced by you, Quickheal does a good support. We, in the recent past, I've seen a couple of my clients have successfully got their data back because they were using Quickheal with ransomware support, and the data was backed up so they only lost the data for 2 days, and the last backup data was available for them. So that's a good software which you can download. And you need to update all these softwares as you download, because downloading does not give you a solution. Every week, sometimes critical updates are received even on emergency, but every week there are applications which comes up with their security patches. You need to download those patch as well. Mostly important app wise, you have My Permission and WOT. Apart from that, only download apps from Google Play Store and Apple App Store. Do not download third-party applications, because those are